Hey, yo, internets, it's Reggie. I'm going to do something completely different today. I'm going to co-sign this new podcast from Gimlet Media. It's called A Nod. It's hosted by Eric Eddings, who's helped with the production of Mogul, and his best friend, Brittany Luce. It's amazing because it's about the biggest moments and some of the most underexplored aspects of Black culture. And it's great because, you know, you don't hear these conversations, particularly of people from the culture and from people of the culture. I'm going to play one of my favorite Nod episodes right now. It's about the Low Life crew, this legendary, like, crew from Brooklyn, from New York back in the 90s. And after this, I want you to stick around because after the episode, I'm going to talk to Eric about the Nod. So stay tuned.
From Gimlet Media, this is The Nod. I'm Eric Eddings.
And I am Brittany Luce.
So, I've been a huge Polo fan for a long time.
It's an understatement, but yeah.
It was actually kind of a problem for a while.
What do you mean by problem?
So, like, for example, in middle school, we had this, like, big bus trip. You know, you do, like, the overnight trip.
Mm.
It's, like, a big deal.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We went from Memphis to D.C., and my mom gave me some money for, like, lunch and souvenirs. You know, it was supposed to last me throughout the whole time.
What did you do with the money?
See, what happened was we stopped at an outlet store on the way, and they had a polo shop, like a polo outlet. Yeah, I went crazy in there. I spent every last dime of my money, but like I wanted to come back with as many different pieces as possible, so it looked like I got like really high value,
uh-huh.
You know?
Okay.
But I could only afford t-shirts. So I literally bought like 6 or 7 polo t-shirts and blew all my money to the point where a teacher had to actually loan me money for the rest of the trip to be able to like eat and stuff.
I'm going to give you a pass on this only because you were 13.
Yeah. Needless to say, polo drove me to do some crazy things. And the reason why I was so into polo, it actually started online. Like when I was that age, I would Google to find like images and websites for like polo inspiration, LOSPO, if you will, you know? You're laughing with me, right?
If only you had an Instagram, if only.
Right? Oh my God. But in these searches, like I started to like notice something, you know? It was like the same people were actually popping up image after image. It was like candids, like folks would be in the club, on the corner. It looked like the early 90s. It was a group of people literally in all polo, like polo from the top down.
Mm.
Hat, jacket, shirt, shirt over it, scarf.
You know about that life.
Polo jeans, you know? Polo was like a really preppy brand. You know, it was made for like white folks who do like crew and shit like that. But the way they wore it, it was different. It felt like hood. It was a little oversized. Everyone's hat was turned to the back, not like crimped down like a dad hat. This was a big deal for me as a kid. Like seeing the stuff up on my computer at home, they were just so fresh. Like in this way, I wasn't. And I wanted that, you know? Like I wanted to look just like that.
So like who were these guys?
Well, they were like an official group.
They're like a squad.
Yes.
Like a polo squad.
They had a name.
They had a name?
Yes. The Low Lives. And the other day, I was thinking about the Low Lives, and I started to look into them. And the more I went down the rabbit hole, I realized they put polo on the map for a lot of kids like me. And the story of how they did that blew my mind. I heard all about it from one of the Low Lives founders.
It's Thurston Howell III, Polo Rican, Skillionaire, Low Life General, MGV, Brownsville all day.
My man said Polo Rican.
And it's accurate, though. So the story of how polo went from the streets of New York to my living room in Memphis, it starts with this guy. In 1988, Thurston was a teenager going by the name Vic Lowe. He and his friends would trek from Brownsville, Brooklyn, into Manhattan, and their crew was massive.
Imagine, you know, 40 dudes out hanging out, partying, and they just link up with another 50, 60 dudes, and they start hanging together in one night. Our main spot was Times Square, when Times Square was considered the deuce, when it was grimy and dirty, and there was pimps and prostitutes and pushers, and, you know, it was a whole different environment up there. It was pretty dangerous.
Thurston and his friends were from the Marcus Garvey Projects in Brownsville, but they ended up linking up with another crew from Crown Heights to form, like, a super crew, you know? And are you ready for this?
Uh-huh.
So they would go into department stores and just, like, swarm the place, folks everywhere, grabbing everything that they could. I'm talking shirts, sweaters, pants, even scarves, definitely hats. They just snatch everything and bolt out the door, trying to avoid every single cop on the way.
Oh, what?
Listening to the shit was riveting.
I mean, I see why.
And so all these kids from different parts of Brooklyn and Queens decided to join together and form a massive crew. And together, they found this mutual love for looking really fresh, sticking up tourists, and shoplifting designer threads, you know. And of course, the brand that brought them all together was...
Polo, obviously.
Yes. Polo was their favorite brand because it had super bright colors and prints. And they settled on a name, the Lowlifes. Because the only other option would have been, like, the Po-Life crew. And, you know, that's, like, too close to home.
That's not aspirational.
Exactly. So the Lowlifes became a family. And like any family, there was a little sibling rivalry. Who was the freshest? Was it you?
Oh, everybody in Lowlife's going to say it was them. Of course I'm going to say it was me. I was fly-ass motherfucker. Not only that, I was Puerto Rican. You know, everybody was black in Lowlife at this time, but... being Puerto Rican, all the black girls love you. That's all I can say.
I don't have anything to say about that.
Okay, so the jury is still out on who was the freshest in the crew. But, like, Thurston had the sauce, you know? He became, like, one of the leaders of the Lowlifes, especially on their boosting sprees. They would take whatever they could grab and bring it back to Brooklyn. They'd keep some of the pieces for themselves, but the rest they'd resold in the neighborhood for, like, a much cheaper than retail price. All this, it was exciting for them. Like, every new boost was an adventure.
Just imagine, you know, you're going to hit a store, you got a target. We all ride in the train together. We know where we're going. People were so anxious to beat out the guy next to you. When the train doors would open up, everybody would race to the store to get in. Just race you there and try to take more than you could take and run out with more than the next person. This was a constant everyday thing.
You gotta be so fast to do that. Like, I'm just trying to think of what it takes to have a whole group of people walk into a department store and just, like, rush it.
I don't know. Literally, I don't know. I would have been the first one caught, straight up.
That's coordination, though.
Yes. So they were boosting, and it was illegal. But it helped them make bread, make ends meet, and, like, just feel a little better about, you know, life in the PJs.
We all grew up poor with shit. Like, if you would see me on the street, I was probably one of the freshest dudes you saw in your life. But when you came to my home, I didn't even have furniture. My crib was fucked up. You know what? I would bring a girl home to my house just like that. She would never complain about how my house looked bad or I didn't have furniture and shit like that, because I was confident regardless. I knew who I was. All of us lowlifes were like that.
So all throughout the late 80s and early 90s, they kept boosting and making serious money off it. And soon, folks outside New York wanted in.
My boy Boostin' Billy had ventured out to Philadelphia in the late 80s, and he spread the culture through Philly crazy. And I would travel to a different state, and I would be Polo down, and somebody in a different state would tell me, oh, yeah, you on that low-life stuff, not even knowing who I am or anything.
And what was that like to hear somebody tell you about your own shit? Like, you know, like, to bring that back to you.
We were some egotistic maniacs at the time as well, so that shit was just stroking your ego. There was no humbleness, you know, with it at the time.
So, like, now the boosting culture is starting to pop outside the city, and love for Polo itself is just spreading like wildfire. And actually, it wasn't just the boosting. See, a lot of folks refer to the late 80s as the golden age of hip-hop. And the lowlifes were in the thick of it.
We were everywhere the rappers were. If you look at music videos from the 80s, 90s, you've seen a lot of rappers get with the culture of Polo as well. And massive rappers were shouting us out in their songs. You know, it's a long list. Ziggy, the rap group Ziggy, was actually the first rap group out there that was spreading and showing the culture. Talib Kweli, Raekwon was repping it heavy. Onyx always bigged us up. Jay-Z bigs us up in his music.
Hip-hop was always about being fresh. But these guys, they were the freshest. And all the rappers took notice. And did you guys know them personally? Like, was it just you saw each other in the club and they liked what you were doing, you liked what they were doing?
I mean, I was in prison just watching all this stuff on TV.
After the break, Thurston has an epiphany in his jail cell. Welcome back. So, like, the thing about crime is eventually you're going to get caught. Thurston would find himself in and out of jail. And at the same time, it turned out there was a flip side to getting famous. More and more people knew about the lowlifes. And, you know, that was cool. Like, you see yourself in magazines and rap songs. But the cops didn't care. And more lowlifes got locked up.
You were representing in Rikers Island in the same form and manner. And wearing all that Polo in jail, that solidified a lot of us and showed what we were, you know, and it's really helped to establish the respect we had from prison to the street.
And actually, ending up in jail was one of the better scenarios. See, being a lowlife meant you constantly had a target on your back.
Just hanging on your own fucking block is murder and mayhem every day. People were stealing all the clothes. We bringing that shit home. The motherfuckers was coming to take it from us. You know, like the neighborhood was coming for it. And they knew we were doing this on a daily basis. It became dangerous. Like, people died.
Died?
Yeah, so basically they would steal all this stuff and come back, and they were looking real fresh. They had, like, you know, hundreds of dollars of designer gear on. And, like, folks in the hood would come up to him and be like, I want what you got. Run that.
Wow.
Yeah, they were losing people all over the place. Like, members were getting picked off by the cops and rival crews. And even Thurston ran out of luck. He went to jail on violent crime charges. Things were looking pretty dire.
Now I'm sitting in jail looking at life. And then I didn't get life. So I'm like, I'm not going to get this shot again. I got another shot. I got to do something. I had to put that shit to the side. I had to stop. You know, or my life was going to be over. I was just going to be in prison forever.
And that's when things changed for Thurston. He linked up with some people in prison that told him even if he gave up boosting, like, it didn't mean his life was over. They started pointing out to him, like, hey, man, there are other ways you can get thrills. It doesn't have to be illegal. And Thurston, he'd always loved one thing, rapping. And when he heard that, he was like, oh, well, maybe that could be a legal way for me to make money. Plus,
I could still get that same feeling off of writing a fucking song. And then that's when my career began. Low life from the old gold cipher, the Polo throw with the night touch. From the era of the DMC leather,
saw in the silk Riviera, peeling sweater. So Thurston's released from jail and decides to leave boosting behind. And he's having the time of his life as an artist. And it was then that he realized, like, if he could get his shit together, the rest of the lowlifes could do the same.
Dudes always had it in them to be every way possible they want to be. You know, that everybody was mostly forced to be gangsters and shit because of the environments we were lived in, you know? But everybody had senses at the same time and smarts and intelligence to know that this wasn't going to be the way forever.
he made it his mission to get the lowlifes to go legit. And that wasn't always easy. Sometimes Thurston had to get a little blunt.
Listen, motherfucker, I'm gonna tell you like this. You ain't coming around me doing that bullshit. Like when I started doing rap shows and shit, you know, I got 30 motherfuckers want to come with me to see me perform. And I let everybody know, yo, don't rob nobody when we go to these spots. Don't fuck nothing up. Then if you go against what the fuck we saying, we going to get you.
It's like the conversations we have every time we go.
I was going to say, before every live show, you're always telling me to make sure I don't rob anybody.
Don't rob anybody today.
But
do that.
I appreciate in this moment, though, that Thurston is like setting the example, setting his boundaries, but still being very authentically himself.
Right? So, like, Thurston's rap career is blowing up. And meanwhile, he's trying to turn around the lowlife's image.
I needed to do promotions. I needed to do different things. Engineer, and you know, a lot of lowlife founders and stuff were pure gangsters. I couldn't get none of these gangster motherfuckers to do nothing like administrative work, you know, and things like that. Everybody was too focused on being a gangster.
Being a gangster had been a big part of what made the lowlifes lowlifes. But as Thurston went around the globe touring, he saw how people dug the lowlife culture. And he got an idea.
I was meeting all these other polo heads. And when I would see how they would embrace me, like, you know, I was fairly a new artist, not too many people knew about. But they knew about Vic Lowe. They knew about me as a lowlife or what I was on the streets and things like that. So these people were gravitating to me, but out of sincerity and things like that and wanting to help. I felt that these dudes needed to be mixed up with the gangster dudes. Like, they all had something to learn from each other to kind of balance it out a little better. And that's exactly what happened.
And after that, like, it wasn't even about the boosting. The lowlifes expanded to include all sorts of members, people who had never stole a day in their life. I'm talking official lowlife chapters in places like Toronto, Tokyo, New Zealand.
New Zealand?
Yes. Kiwis.
Kiwis. I was about to say.
Low Kiwi.
And they were about that lowlife.
They were. And they have these like meetups where a DJ will like spin records while folks trade rare polo pieces. Like the boosting was in their rear view. And being a lowlife, it became something more.
It means culture now. It evolved into a culture.
And right around when the lowlifes went legit, polo went public. And the IPO was huge, like over $700 million huge. And you know, who's to say if the lowlifes were responsible for that? But you've got to wonder. Either way, they're still obsessed with polo. And they're still repping the culture here in Brooklyn heavy. My producer James hit me up with some news the other day. The lowlifes were having a barbecue here in Brooklyn where it all began.
How did you even feel?
It was like the promise of Christmas morning, you know? So on this like super hot Saturday morning, I went out to like Highland Park in Brooklyn. And like what I saw was wild.
And welcome to the 12th annual Low Life Barbecue, y'all. Salute. Back low. Low White, get your grub on. If you don't have your orange band, stop being a cheap bastard. It's $20. Go get your grub on, all right? Let's go, baby.
Sending this one out to my man Killer B.
Imagine the flyest black and brown folks you've ever seen, all in one spot. Like they were all there just decked out from head to toe in polo Ralph Lauren.
Now the culture is not about the boosting, but we can never forget that that's where it come from.
That's Sheena. She's married to one of the original lowlifes. His name's Rack Low. When I caught up with her, she had just put a couple burgers on the grill, and she explained how the picnic got started.
Initially, it was to just get a couple of friends together because, you know, life was going so fast, and everybody was having kids, and, you know, we didn't really have a place and a time to get together. So we said once a year, you know, we want to invite all our friends, feed them, bring everybody together, and, you know, just do something special.
This is what the lowlifes do now. They cook out, they have meetups, Thurston's still rapping, but he's also running a low-life clothing line. And they told me they do a lot of charity work now, too, like back-to-school drives, giving away turkeys at Thanksgiving, and raising money for scholarships. It's like a hood Rotary Club. But at the end of the day, no one forgets that the lowlifes changed hip-hop fashion forever.
It's fun, man. It's fun. It's history. It's all history. It's all hip-hop. You know what I'm saying?
And everyone I talked to brought it up, like this one cat, Ramses.
I used to read about, you know, half of these people here on magazines, how they used to, you know, boost and go crazy for this low game. And, you know what I'm saying? To me, it was different. But, you know, now to be together and show love and spread bread and do all this is all low life forever.
And that's the part of what's so amazing about this. Like, the lowlifes went on this crazy journey. Like, because of them, hip hop is different. Like, what we wear is different. Like, hell, if I'm being honest, like, me as a kid, like, I'm different. But even though their lives have changed so much and the crew has gotten so big, the original lowlifes, they're just as tight as they were in the 80s. Here's Thurston again.
Oh, lowlife is my family. They're still my family. Regardless of success and, you know, people moving around and, you know, it never changed who my family was. My best friends are still my best friends from 30 years ago. You know, that it's really a family. There's really love and loyalty, you know, like, that's rare. Yeah, I know you've heard the term, there's no honor amongst thieves. I beg to differ.
Yeah. 2L's up. Much love to everybody that came out. Low Life Barbecue 2017. Representing that love and loyalty. You know what I mean? No matter where you came from.
I don't know why you think just because you wear polo, you a lowlife?
Yeah, who him?
Yeah.
You not a lowlife. You wasn't with us when we was killing B. Altman's and Macy's.
It was the Million Man Rush.
I was there.
The Million Man Rush.
The Nod is produced by me, Eric Eddings, with Brittany Luce, Kate Parkinson Morgan, and James T. Green. Our senior producer is Sara Abdurrahman. We are edited by Jorge Just and Annie Rose Strasser, with editing help from Neil Drummond, engineering from Matthew Bowl and Cedric Wilson. Our theme music is by Khalid B. Other original music in the show by Khalid B, Taxstar, and Bobby Lord. Additional sound elements provided by Christopher Pfeiffer. Special thank you to Thurston Howell III for sharing his music with us.
It is, right? We always look out for each other, right?
There you go. Yeah. Exactly.
So we're talking about the lowlifes right now and Thurston Howell and this whole phenomenon of Ralph Lauren and how it inspired a lot of kids in Brooklyn and New York City from the late 80s and the early 90s?
I mean, it was crazy. Like, growing up, I had heard of the lowlifes, but I never knew how deep the story was. You know, like, I actually never knew they boosted.
Now, let me ask you this, because I know how crazy lowheads can get. Did they have, like, with, like, some of the barbecue utensils, like Ralph Lauren?
They didn't have the barbecue utensils weren't Ralph Lauren, but they did have, like, membership cards,
really?
Like, physical membership cards.
Was it Love and Loyalty, right?
Yeah, it says, like, Love and Loyalty. It looks like a black card, yeah. And it has, like, official Low Life member printed right on it. And, like, I was shocked by that. They also have these, like, crazy kind of medallion chains. Not quite, like, not like a blinged out chain or something like right. that. But, like, but, like, it has, like, these cool crests. Like, they made a
crest.
Yeah.
What is it about polo, man?
Honestly, for me, like, I grew up, I was a corny kid. You know, I'm a little bit of a square. But polo felt like the perfect in-between of, like, I could rock with, like, the cool kids, you know, like, the folks who was a little more hood. But I also, like, if I need to pull my pants up and look more, you know, quote unquote, respectable right. for, like, my mom and stuff like that, like, it was just, like, right in between. And it helped that, like, you saw folks in videos, like, wearing polo, you know, like, in magazines. Like, it just, it felt like this iconic style that black and brown folks specifically could, like, flip and take it and, like, rock it in their own way.
Yeah, it was aspirational.
Yeah.
So, like, even though, like, all these inner city kids knew nothing about the actual polo sport, they could aspire or felt like they were included into that whole thing, or, you know, skiing or water polo. It's aspirational and it's understated, man.
Yeah, it's like the closest I could get to the country club.
Exactly.
You know, without needing to be like what folks in country clubs are
exactly,
like.
Exactly, exactly.
Yeah.
So, Eric, man, like, it's funny because when I talk to my friends that aren't of Black culture. Like, I find myself a lot explaining to them, you know, what the nod is.
I mean, it comes from, like, the Negro nod.
The Negro nod.
Yeah, it's where, basically, it's like, you know, two Black people, they see each other in a space, and it's just like the, it's like a super quick acknowledgement.
Quick, subtle.
Yes.
You could have 50 people in the room, and they wouldn't notice that you guys made a connection.
And it's like that link. And in that moment, you know, like, it's like, I got you. And so, like, with the show, The Nod, what we try to do is, like, take a deeper dive and to look at, like, aspects of Black culture that, like, people might think of as, like, mundane, you know, but that have, like, kind of a deeper meaning. And we try to, like, capture that deeper meaning.
So what are some of the other things that you guys discuss in The Nod, man?
So on our first episode, we actually talk about Black sexuality. And there is...
How so?
So there's this social media star. Her name is Glamazon Taomi. And
Glamazon Taomi.
Yes.
I got to check her out.
And she does these, like, YouTube tutorials, literally. Like, you know, she was listening to Beyonce's Drunk in Love.
Right.
And, like, you know, Beyonce's, like, surfboard. And so where surfboard is a, like, a sex position, she actually breaks that down to show you how to do it.
How to surfboard?
Yeah, exactly.
With
in the tub. With a T.
With a T.
With a T.
Surfboard.
Yeah. You got hard T.
Yeah.
She wants to make it accessible. So it's doing that, but it's also making it accessible to the Black community. Like, we can actually see ourselves in erotic situations. So we connect her to this author, Zane, who has, like...
Zane.
Yeah, has a massive history of talking about Black folks and sex.
What's the biggest book?
Addicted.
Addicted, okay. All right, are you guys having fun, man?
We're having so much fun, man. It's crazy. It's really, it's awesome. Like, I was talking to my mom the other day. She asked me what I was working on. I was like, yeah, I'm working on this story about do-rags. And she was like, what? She's like, they paying you to do that? And I was like, yeah, bro, I'm working on a story about do-rags. But yeah, man, it's been really fun making the show. I think we got some cool topics that people are going to be interested
in. I can imagine it's so fun working with Brittany, man.
Yeah, I mean... Yes.
She's intense, but she seems so fun too, man.
I mean, mind you, she's been my friend for like 12 years. So right. Like at this point, you know, it's like working with your sibling.
Right.
It's like, it's great and terrible all the time.
I can imagine, man.
But no, Brittany's awesome. Like, I mean, it's cool to be able to just vibe with somebody, like, and almost like in the same way that you would nod with somebody. Like, I can look at her and automatically kind of know what she's thinking.
That's dope, man.
It's nice.
Yeah.
I can't complain.
You know, Eric, I already know the answer, but you sold me on this, man. How did the internet get to listen to this amazing show called The Nod?
Well, the great thing about podcasts is they are available on many platforms.
Yeah.
So you can check us out anywhere you listen to podcasts, you can find The Nod.
Right.
On Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, the whole nine.
SoundCloud?
SoundCloud, we're there.
And internet, you know what to do. Rate, subscribe, and comment. Let's make this the hottest show. Other than Mogul, let's make this the hottest show on the interwebs.
Yes.
Congratulations, man.
Thanks a lot.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate it.